Good evening. I call the Rockingham County Board of Commissioners regular scheduled meeting for April the 1st to order. We work from an agenda, and the first item on the agenda is I'm going to call Pastor Charles Howell from the Speedwell Presbyterian Church in Reidsville to come forward and deliver our invocation. That will be followed by Pledge of Allegiance, and it will be provided by Miss Lena Wilder. Please stand.
Let's pray. Eternal God, we pause today to remember you and all that you mean to us. In you we live and move and have our being. In your world, in the world in which we come, we often forget that things visible, tangible, sensual, so obsess our thought and fill our eyes and preoccupy our hearing that we lose sight of the significant audience with you. Make things real to us that are real. Let the small things seem small and the great things seem great. Rearrange, we pray, the perspective of our life. Round our little days and throw such horizons that the seen and the temporal may take the lower place and that the unseen and the eternal capture our imagination and our faith. We pray for ourselves, but we think of all that you desire to do in the world at large. Across boundaries, race, nations, over prejudices that serve folk from folks, that sever folk from folk, your purpose is run, all-inclusive for all the good of all people. This is your purpose. As we pray for it, may we open up our lives to it so that through us that may pass. We pray for the leaders of our country, for our president, for our state leaders, for our local leaders, and particularly for these commissioners tonight. We pray for them that there may be peace and there may be unity among us so that we can worship you and share with one another and serve one another in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Ask Ms. Wilder to come forward. Come to the podium. Please face the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. All right, gentlemen, I'd like to thank Ms. Wilder for leading us in the pledge. She's part of our Rockingham County Teen Council or Youth Council, so we appreciate you being here tonight and leading our Pledge of Allegiance. Item number four is approval of the agenda. Gentlemen, you've had an opportunity to look at the agenda. Is there any additions, completion, or deletions of the agenda?
I'll make a motion to approve the agenda with one addition, which is closed session pursuant to NCGS 143-318-11A4 and A5. That's location of or expansion of industries and instruct negotiating agents.
We'd be willing to make it item number 13A, I guess.
Yes, that's fine.
All righty. Gentlemen, I have a motion to approve the agenda, including item number 13A. Do I have a second?
You do.
I got a second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like sign. So moved. Thank you. Item number five is going to be recognition. John, if I could, I'll get you to step around to the front with me. From time to time, we take the opportunity to recognize an outstanding volunteer. And at this time, I'd like to get Ms. Elwanda Ensley to come forward. It's always fun to stand up front, isn't it? Ms. Ensley. Ms. Ensley's been recognized tonight as one of Rockingham County's outstanding volunteers. She is an annual fixture at the Celebrate Veterans Program. Not only does she maintain a contact list, but helps solicit door prizes for the program. She also oversees the planning, preparation, and serving of food. She is involved with the Grief Share Program at Speedwell Presbyterian Church and helps members with many other functions. Ms. Ensley donates her time and energy at the Wright Event Center in Eden, which gives a portion of the proceeds to help the church youth programs. Ms. Ensley has a special place in her heart for seniors. She takes time to talk to those who are lonely and always provides them with encouragement. For those who can no longer drive at night, she has become their chauffeur. Ms. Ensley seeks out those in need and offers something better than money. She offers her time. There are not many people like Elwanda who just sit and listen with no expectation in return. This kindness of this type of person is priceless. So on behalf of the Board of Education, they appreciate it too. But on behalf of the Board of Commissioners, I want to thank you for everything you do for Rockingham County. And on behalf of the Rockingham County Commissioners, here's a little something. Outstanding Volunteer of the Month is Elwanda Ensley for dedication to the community and the citizens of Rockingham County, signed this day by all the commissioners. Thank you very much.
If you want to say a few words, we'll give you the microphone, too.
I really want to say a thing. You just need to get up every morning and decide to be a blessing to someone that day.
Thank you very much. Let's stand right here. We'll take a picture. Thank you. All right, gentlemen, the next item on the agenda is proclamations. I'm going to ask County Manager Lance Metzler to read the proclamations. The first one's going to be designated for Month of the Child with the partnership. Representing the partnership here today, I guess, will be Ms. April Cox and Dawn Sharaba. I always pronounce your name incorrectly. I hope I did. Thank you. And of course, if y'all would like to stand up and be recognized for what you do for the youth of our community. Okay, and I'll ask Lance to read that proclamation.
Yes, Mr. Chair. Proclaiming April 2019 as the Month of the Young Child in Rockingham County, whereas the Rockingham County Partnership for Children, in its 21st year, provides services to young children and their families, along with our early childhood community in conjunction with the North Carolina Association for the Education of Young Children and the National Association for the Education of Young Children, are celebrating the month a young child, April 2019, whereas these organizations are working to promote and inspire high-quality early childhood experiences for our state's youngest citizens that can provide a foundation of learning and success for children throughout Rockingham County, and whereas teachers and others who work with or on behalf of young children from birth through age 8 are making a difference in the lives of young children in Rockingham County deserves thanks and recognition. And whereas public policies that support early learning for all young children are vital to the future of our young children and to the prosperity of our society. Now, therefore, in honor and appreciation of the invaluable services provided by teachers and child care workers in Rockingham County, the Board of Commissioners proclaims April 2019, Month of the Young Child in Rockingham County, and encourage all citizens to support and invest in early childhood education in Rockingham County.
This is
the first day of April 2019.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. April, is there anything you'd like to share with us about what the partnership has going on? I thought you might want to plug your children's parade.
Yes. Thank you. So I'm April Cox, resident of Stoneville, and here tonight representing the Rockingham County Partnership for Children. So first, thank you for the time and investment that you guys are putting into our young children and families in Rockingham County. I do want to highlight, you have a packet in front of you, so we left you with a children's book. We ask that you maybe read that and then pass it on to a young child in your life. We have the annual, Week of the Young Child Children's Parade coming up on Thursday, April 11th. That will be next Thursday, downtown Reidsville. This is an annual event where children and families and all of our early education programs come out and we celebrate. It's just a way to bring public attention to young children and their needs and their families, and also recognize all the programs that are working to meet those needs of children. So that's one thing. And then next Saturday, the 13th, is our annual Go Far 5K event in Eden, another event that we host here in the county that just promotes young children and all the things that they're capable of doing. I want to personally thank Mr. Richardson and all of your efforts. He's a board member of ours, but also very involved in our Kids Ready initiative and other early childhood initiatives we have going on here in the county. So thank you again.
Thank you. All right, Mr. Manager, we'll move to 6B, Child Abuse Prevention Month. Here we have Ms. Kathy Mary, and we'll do the proclamation, and I'll give you a moment to speak, okay?
Mr. Chair, proclaiming April 2019 as Child Abuse Prevention Month in Rockingham County, where children are vital to our state's future success, prosperity, and quality of life, as well as being our most vulnerable assets, and whereas child abuse and neglect affect quality of life, and is a community responsibility. And whereas all children deserve to have safe, stable, nurturing homes and communities to foster healthy growth and development. And whereas communities provide parents with social support, parental and child development education, and concrete resources needed to ensure all children grow to their full potential. And whereas effective child abuse prevention strategies and success due in part to partnerships created among community-based organizations. Now, therefore, the Rockingham County Board of Commissioners hereby proclaims April 2019 as Child Abuse Prevention Month and calls upon citizens, community agencies, faith groups, medical facilities, elected leaders, and businesses to maximize their support of families in an effort to prevent child abuse and strengthen our community. This the first day of April 2019.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. Kathy, is there anything you want to come up and share with us, maybe a little bit about what went on today? In the cold weather.
All I can say, it's much warmer in here this afternoon than it was this morning at 9 o'clock. Many of you noticed a good portion of you all were there this morning. We appreciate it, and I just want to say for the community members that are here, if they noticed when they came in tonight, the pinwheels that are planted out in front of the Governmental Center, they'll be there all month. Each one of those pinwheels represents a child in foster care in Rockingham County. The social workers here that work for us here in the county and those children that are here in the county, a lot of them are not placed here in our county because we don't have enough foster homes. Again, that's still always a need for us, and for anybody that would be interested, we can come out to your church group, to your organization, speak to them in regards to that or how to prevent child abuse. I'm glad to know, and we always do, it's the month of the young child. It's also Child Abuse Prevention Month, and we do partner with the folks at the Partnership for Children every year, every month, every time we turn around for everything that we need. They provide parenting to our parents that we work with, and we do work with our community partners, just as the proclamation said, and we're glad to have them, and we're glad for the support that the commissioners give us and the work that we do. We appreciate everything you do, but just pay attention to those pinwheels out there. It's a very windy day, and we haven't lost any of them yet today, but they're really pretty out there today. Thank you all for everything you do.
Thank you, Kathy, and thank you for everything you and your staff do. Hopefully next year when we do this, we'll have more people out there than we have pinwheels. Yeah, that'd be really great. Had a great crowd. But, gentlemen, if you'd like, we'd do both of these proclamations at one time, if I could have a motion.
So moved.
I'll second.
I got a motion by Commissioner Richardson, second by Commissioner Hall. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Motion carries. All right. Item number 7 is consent agenda. Gentlemen, these are non-controversial items. If anyone in the audience should have any questions about any items contained on our consent agenda, feel free to contact the county manager, and he'll be happy to discuss all of these with you, or any of these with you. Having said that, gentlemen, do I have a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
Got a motion by Commissioner Berger. Do I have a second?
Yes, second.
Second by Commissioner Richardson. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Motion carries. Next item on the agenda is public comment. Mr. Manager, I'll ask you to read our disclaimer for public comment.
Yes, Mr. Chair. The public comment period shall be for the purpose of allowing members of the public to present any matter pertaining to county business or items on Board of Commissioners' agenda. Remarks shall be addressed directly to the Board of Commissioners and not to the staff, the audience, or media. The chairperson will open up the public comment period. Any speaker who wishes to speak shall approach the podium and not speak from his or her seat. Each speaker should clearly state his or her name and physical address when he or she approaches the podium. Any citizen shall be allotted 3 minutes. Citizens will be allowed to yield their time on a specific topic by utilizing one more attendee's time. This will allow no more than 6 minutes. I will time the speakers and notify the chairman of their limit. The time clock will start with 3 minutes unless you yield the time to 6 minutes. You will hear a beep at 1 minute to alert you to wrap up your comments. If you are yielded time or time is yielded to you, then please let the chairman know in advance. Speakers will not be allowed to campaign for public office, promote private business ventures, or use language of a personal nature which insults or demeans any person or which, when directed at a public official, is not related to his or her official duties. The Board of Commissioners may accept written comments in lieu of oral statements, which statements can be delivered to the candidate's office. Chair?
Thank you, Mr. Manager. All right, the first person signed up to speak is Ms. Mary Martin. Ms. Martin, if you'll come up and give your name and address, please.
Good evening. I'm Mary Martin, 702 West Idaho Street, Madison, North Carolina. I'm here representing the Beauty of Madison, Order of the Eastern Star. I am their worthy matron, and I am here tonight to personally give invitations to all of our commissioners to attend a community event that we will be having, Bringing the Neighbor Back to the Neighborhood. It will be on April the 27th from 10 a.m. until 6. At any point in time during that period, we would love for you to come. It will be held at the Madison Med and Recreation Department. We will be doing cornhole, popcorn, cotton candy, bounce house, spades. We will have a Twin City rivalry basketball game, Madison town officials versus Med and town officials. I'm not biased, but the winner, their initials will begin with M-A. So that will be the winner. We will also have the Early Childhood Educators Club from Rockingham Community College. They're going to come over and do something with young children there. I am the volunteer coordinator for the Salvation Army, so you will see the kettle there. We're going to ring the Salvation Army bell and collect items for those. I have a young man that makes candies, and part of his proceeds go to Disabled Veterans Association. He will be there selling his candies. So we'll be doing various things that will help the community. Lee Blackburn, this friend of mine that owns an insurance company, she will be there doing kits for the children. So we'll get that done. So it's going to be a day of live music all day. We're gonna have a floss contest, so y'all get to practicing. We're gonna do that. So we want y'all to participate. We want y'all to come and just have fun. And the gist of this is that we don't know our neighbors, and we want to just get out and just get to know each other, have fun all day, get to know our commissioners. I have personally invited the Rockingham County Board of Education, so they said that they would be there. And I know that you will be there. And I thank you so very kindly. And we look forward to you being there on April 27th from 10 a.m. until 6 at any point in time. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ms. Martin, if you will make sure you get up with Miss Mabel Scott, she put that on our community calendar.
I forgot to tell you that Miss Mabel Scott is going to be the mistress of ceremony for that day.
Oh, she's already got it on the community calendar.
Yes, and that's in your invitation. That's on your flyer. So, Miss Mabel Scott, I talked with her in January.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for what you're doing for the community. All right, and the next item, the next person signed up to speak is Mr. Doug Isley.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. Doug Isley, 1790 Flat Rock Road, Reidsville, North Carolina.
Also, school board member, and I'm a liaison for the school board. I just wanted to come out this evening and thank everyone that came out this past weekend for our Team Up to Clean Up event at Moorhead High School. The county, the school system, along with the city of Eden, some churches, members of the community came out in record numbers. I think we had one of the largest crowds that we've ever had, and it was over 120 people that Dr. Shotwell said he thinks attended. I think Charlie, Craig, Kimberly, Paul, and myself were out, and quite a few people that I didn't see because I got there late on in the afternoon. But I did want to thank the community for coming out. We did a fantastic job as far as getting things done. Everybody was very enthusiastic about it, and hopefully this will give us some momentum for our next event. And for Ms. Martin, she did invite the school board, and I appreciate that, but I don't know that they want me trying to cut the rug out there. So thank y'all. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you, Doug. All righty. Ms. Ann Fish. Oh, Mr. Corey Scott, if y'all both want to come up together. I think you're sharing this topic. We'll let you go together in the interest of time. Yeah, it's fine. They go.
I'm Ann Fish. I live at 331 Wilshire Drive in Eden. You guys all know me. And when you see me here, you know that I'm going to be talking about one or two things, either to celebrate veterans, I can't talk, or the food drive. And tonight I'm going to yield my time, if it's okay, Mr. Chairman, to Mr. Scott here. They have got him to and his wife to help us, and the band has done a tremendous job with organization. He's gotten everything organized except me. But this is Corey Scott. He and his wife moved here about a year ago from upstate New York, I think around Corning, to get away from the snow, and they love it here. But anyway, this is Mr. Scott. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Commissioners. Appreciate the opportunity to speak. By the way, thank you. It's a great county. One of the things I mentioned to Mabel earlier is that as I've traveled around to the various places in the county delivering boxes, I've been really impressed with the quality of the facilities and the beauty of the facilities, the libraries, the government offices, stuff like that. I mean, this is really impressive considering the area that I just came from. So I think it bespeaks well-managed organization. So I'd like to, I'm from 401 Farmington Drive in Reidsville. And I've, like Ann said, I've been here for for almost a year, and was asked to participate in the countywide food drive. You've seen some of the boxes. In fact, this is one of the boxes, the kind of boxes that we've been passing out. We created posters for everybody, for these boxes, so that people would know all that's going on about the food drive. It also has the information about the organizations that are supported in that food drive. And that includes the Cooperative Christian Ministries, the Hand of God in Western Rockingham County, Men in Christ in Reidsville, the Reidsville Soup Kitchen, Rockingham County Veterans Coalition Food Pantry, the Salvation Army Pantry at Reidsville, and the Salvation Army Soup Kitchen Service Center in Eden. So what we've done is we've gone to several locations in the county and we've delivered these boxes. We put a little sign also on here that says, make a difference in the lives of the hungry in the county. Also, what we added in here this year is a website. So all the organizations that are participating in this food drive where their drop-off boxes are being located, we're putting that information on the website, also the organizations that are benefiting from this particular, for this effort. You know, we sometimes miss the problem that we have in the county. There's a lot of people who go to these food pantries every week to get the sustenance that they need on a weekly basis. We learned that there's well over 100 people, veterans, that are homeless in the county. And so the intent of these of this food drive is to provide the necessary foods, items that they can put on their pantry shelves to help all these people who are in need. Our goal this year is to collect 50,000 items. So far, we've collected about 2,700, but this is new in the month. Usually, April is the month where things really happen. And what we would like to request is that you talk to your organizations, to the people that you associate with at the cities, at the county, to get people to donate to this food drive effort so that we can fill up these pantry shelves and be able to take care of the needs of our organization. Again, I drive you to the rcfooddrive.org, which is our dedicated website for information about the food drive and the contact information if you need more information.
Thank you very much.
Any questions or anything from anyone? Great. Thank you again. I appreciate all of your effort to help with this. And all the fire departments have been great. There's signs on all the fire departments, even articles in the paper about what the fire departments have done. So we really appreciate all your help.
Thank you. Thank you for everything you do and everything that Ms. Fish is doing. Thank you very much. All righty, gentlemen. Item number 9, Lance Metzler.
Yes, Mr. Chair. I've only got one item, and it's pretty simple. It's to a request to reappoint Karen Tucker from Reidsville and reappoint Keenan Wright from Eden to serve another term on the county's Industrial Facilities and Pollution Control Financing Authority.
Okay. We got two applicants, gentlemen. Do I have a motion to appoint Ms. Karen Tucker and Ms. Keenan Wright?
So moved.
Second.
I got a motion by Commissioner Hall, a second by Commissioner Berger. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Motion carries. Thank you. Item number 10, A, Mr. Ronnie Tate.
Good evening, gentlemen. I've got two items tonight for your consideration. And the first is a request by engineering staff for a change to the Rockingham County Solid Waste Ordinance that would allow the county manager to waive landfill tipping fees for the following groups: civic organizations, faith-based organizations, and nonprofit organizations. This waiver would be granted on a case-by-case basis, with the manager determining to waive the fee, what can and cannot be accepted, and the length of the fee waiver. Groups requesting this waiver would be required to submit the specified county form, which you have in your packet, a minimum 2 weeks before their pickup day or days, and to comply with all regulations of the waiver form. And I can read the language that we're proposing here. It is as follows. The county manager shall have the authority to waive landfill tipping fees for civic organizations, faith-based organizations, and nonprofit organizations at the manager's discretion. These entities may request a waiver of fees for litter remediation projects by submitting a waiver request form that is provided to the county manager or their designee at least 2 weeks in advance of the date of the request. The waiver shall be granted on a case-by-case basis if in the best interest of the county. And the location for this in the Solid Waste Ordinance is Section 9-46. It would be Point A, listed as tipping fee waivers. And I'll be glad to answer any questions.
Do we have something anywhere else in the ordinance that would allow an appeal to the board?
I don't believe so. I don't think.
Okay. John, would we not want to put that in the ordinance to allow folks to appeal to the Board of Commissioners if for some reason they disagreed with the manager's decision?
I believe that would be appropriate underneath that. I believe the UDO does actually have a general appeal process, so we may be able to refer to that general appellate process that's already existing in the UDO.
Okay. So we've got something in place, you think, already?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I've got a couple of questions. On the form, there are several items listed on the form. Mm-hmm. And, John, this may be more of a question for you, but I see that we have requested start and stop dates or one day only. We're limiting to vehicles. But we're also limited to a value of $500. That's on the form. Should that be included in the statute as well, that we're that we're looking to pass?
That would be, you referred to the UDO, if that would be included in the UDO?
Well, in other words, we're getting ready to pass this this solid waste ordinance, and it doesn't mention any of these limits. One of the things on the form, it mentions a $500 limit per year. My question is, you know, if we pass this ordinance tonight and they decide to change the form in 2 weeks to limit it to 2,500 or 5,000, I just want to be sure that, because the form says 500, I want to be sure that the ordinance we pass is $500.
Yes, I would agree, just for consistency's sake, that would be appropriate. Of course, it would go through legal to review and make those final have that final review, but I believe for consistency that would seem appropriate.
Thank you.
Is there anywhere else in our ordinance that has a dollar limit? I mean, it had to come from somewhere to be on the form.
We actually basically copied this form from another locality, I think is where we got the form from, and I think that's what was on theirs.
You got another question?
Right now the proposed ordinance then, or proposed change, does not have any limitations or anything that is listed in here that would kind of be a maximum amount the manager could approve. Is that right?
That's correct. It's up to his discretion. His or her discretion.
What? I have no idea what amount when the faith-based organizations come in and do the cleanup. What's a reasonable value to expect to waive?
Well, the current tipping fee of 36 a ton. That would probably be close to 12 or 13 tons of waste, and I don't think we've ever had anybody bring that amount of waste to us from any of these organizations to get to the $500 limit.
It says in here these entities may request a waiver of fees for litter remediation projects. So that tells me they're not just cleaning up their property. They're going out in the community and doing cleanup.
That's
and then
correct.
They want to dispose of it at a dump at our county landfill.
Mm-hmm.
And I just don't know that we should be thinking about how we limit them on the cost associated with it. To me, if they want to do it every weekend, I appreciate it. I'd rather have the mound of tires that you showed us
right.
the other day.
Mm-hmm.
I'd rather have that mound of tires at our landfill than on the side of our roads all the way across Rockingham County. And so, yeah, and I'm just saying, when I'm sitting here thinking about the limiting on the fees associated with that, and then on the flip side of that, too, it could be an organized county volunteers, you know, not necessarily just a civic group, but just a I don't know, does the youth council count as a civic group? You know, that's a group of youth volunteers that go
right.
out and do a part of their program, a part of their volunteerism as part of what they do. When I read it, that's the first thing that popped off that I thought of was, does it, you know, we talk about civic organization, faith-based organization, or nonprofit organizations. We don't necessarily define those, but you know, it could be just an organized group of citizens in the county that want to mediate, wants to address the litter issue in the county, and they shouldn't have to pay to do it.
Okay. Are you proposing a change to the form?
I would just say that it should be and include some type of organized county volunteers. I don't know what verbiage of this is.
And I think that our intent with this was to allow the manager, when he received those type of requests, you know, I feel like he's capable of saying, okay, this is a worthy organization.
And that's maybe you could just add that to other worthy organization, and Commissioner Travis said leave it at the manager's discretion. I really hope we would never have any necessary appeals to this.
Well,
we got people cleaning up.
As far as the form, we should never have a form that has restrictions that are not adopted by the board, that are not listed in the ordinances.
Okay.
Our forms have to match our ordinances or they're invalid forms.
Okay.
Yeah, I think the essence for some of us, probably all of us, is when somebody, some group, is performing a service of cleaning up public property, be it right away or a park or the river, we don't want to impede that. And I think that's an entirely separate situation from a person's personal property. So whatever language makes that happen, and again, I'm happy with Commissioner Travis' suggestion that the able county manager is most competent to make that decision.
Well, I do agree that, Kevin, we need to distinguish between private property and personal and public property.
Okay.
Ordinance.
All right. Yeah.
But I appreciate what you're doing working on this. At the end of the day, I think it's just this board is after trying to make sure there's no barriers for anybody out there that wants to in any way address the litter issues that's facing our county, public litter issues.
Would the board be more comfortable if I recraft this and bring it back at the next meeting?
I'd be willing to let the county manager assume responsibility for recrafting, because in essence, I believe we stated the principle that we adhere to collectively.
Yeah, and we're talking about taking the $500 limitation off of the form.
Well, I think
for clarity.
Ultimately, we just draft the ordinance, and then they can come up with a form. We don't necessarily have to approve the form, but the form has to match our ordinances, not somebody else's.
Exactly. Okay.
So we probably just need to get a clear ordinance on that. That's probably something that you can work with the county attorney and come back with, and we'll clean
it
up.
All right, I'll be glad
to. And that'll be done. All right.
Do you need a motion?
I guess the question, has any groups approached the county as of today to where we need to act on this tonight?
No.
Because it's a two-week period anyway.
Yeah, no, nobody's approached us.
Okay, so we're good kicking it to the 15th.
Sure.
And, okay.
Motion to table it.
Motion to table to the next meeting.
Got a motion to table this to the next meeting.
I'll second
Commissioner Travis, second by Commissioner Hall. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like sign. Thank you. Item number B.
Yeah.
Okay, hold on just a second, gentlemen. All right, so I have a short PowerPoint presentation tonight. It's provided as sort of thought starters for the board to consider, especially during the upcoming budget session, on some ideas that staff had to address the litter in the county and how to use some county resources or use civic groups to address that and mitigate that litter. The first slide, before I get started, I do want to point out one thing. Last Thursday, we had an Adopt a Highway here, and we had 10 staff folks involved in that, and we collected 160 pounds.
That's
just
great.
In the 2-mile stretch that we have around campus here. That's the single largest amount we've ever collected. Typically, it's in the 30-pound or less range, but for some reason, last week we collected quite a bit around in our area.
Well, I think thank you to you and the staff, all the county staff. I know that we had weather
exactly,
that kind of made that a little bit more difficult than it needed to be on 2 or 3 different occasions. We appreciate you for your willingness to work with.
I've been called the rainmaker now, so for predictive rain.
I don't think it needed much help, but
Okay, so gentlemen, the first slide is just sort of a recap of what we have in place right now, besides the Adopt the Highway, which is the inmate litter program. This program's fully financed by revenues from the Landfill Enterprise Fund. You can see there the initial program assets of van, trucks, trailer, porta-john, the uniforms for the deputy, bulletproof vest, and guns. We provide apparel for the inmates, which include boots and other personal protective equipment. The first year, you can see a pretty significant cost, and that was for the initial capital outlay for the equipment, and that program started in April of 2015. So just for the 3 or 4 months of that year, you can see that was a significant amount. Since then, it is basically running about $150,000 a year, and you can see the total there. And I have an updated total of miles cleaned. It's actually 1,226 miles through February of this year and 7,032 bags of trash collected with that program. Just a little short slide on sources of litter. Everybody knows that litter begets litter. When you see it on the side of the road, maybe enables people to feel like they can do the same thing, or there's no repercussions from doing it. There are some sources for litter listed there. We see a lot of it from uncovered trucks going to and from the landfill, and also from motorists. As you can see, the state of North Carolina spent $19 million last year trying to mitigate this problem, and that doesn't include what the county spent. So on to possible options, and the first one is a way to use community service workers, court-ordered community service, and this would be in conjunction with the sheriff and using code enforcement staff as possible to oversee this. The Landfill Enterprise Fund pays 50% of their salary currently. We would have the deputies use the community service workers on days when the sheriff was not using the inmate road crew assets, where they could have access to the van, truck, and the equipment, and take those workers out on those days to collect litter as needed. The second option would be to hire a litter crew supervisor to work with community service workers. You can see that Rowan County currently has one, the salary listed there. And since this is a non-law enforcement position, you would need, the county would need to provide the capital assets for this, with an estimated startup of approximately $100,000 for that. Third option would be to use a litter crew supervisor and hire part-time county employees for that program. You can see the salary for the supervisor, up to 8 part-time county employees, 16 hours each. It'd have 4 of them working at one time, 2 days per week, with an average pay of $9.50 an hour. You can see the yearly total for that, and also you would need the county would need to purchase vehicles to transport them to and from where the roads are selected to be cleaned. Option 4 is just a variation of that, with instead of having litter crew supervisor, to be supervised by a deputy, either code enforcement or someone working with the sheriff. Option 5, one that we've talked about a little bit tonight earlier, it would be using members of the community, and you would have the enterprise fund would pay nonprofits, organizations of that type, up to $50 per mile for litter pickup. We'd need some help from the risk manager to determine what PPE the county would be obligated to provide. And I think the cost of the program would really would have to see how many people or organizations signed up for this to determine the cost before we know what this program would cost the county. And the last one is one that DOT uses as well, is contracted litter collection service. I think the one thing that stands out in this slide is the private companies collect or clean about 31 miles per day, while other crews average about 5 miles. So there's quite a bit of difference in the number of miles collected and the conditions they're working in versus volunteers or inmate litter. If the board decided to pursue this option, the county would need to do an RFP or RFQ for those services and see if they could locate a vendor that would provide those and have the landfill enterprise fund pay for that. So, and that is the options we had. I'll be glad to answer questions or listen to comments and try to answer those for the board.
Thank you, Ronnie. Is there any questions of Ronnie? Any comments?
Mr. Chair.
Yes,
if,
sir.
Currently, if we have a group or nonprofit who wants to do roadside cleanup, do we provide them with bags or, I know we have the two-color bags that the sheriff uses. Do we help provide them with those type things, or does the DOT?
I don't think DOT does unless you're part of an adopt-a-highway group specifically. As for us, we do not provide those right now. And I think we were sort of looking for some guidance tonight if the board would like to see us provide those to those organizations. And that was part of sort of that first one, the earlier item I brought to the board. If you were going to allow the manager, we could provide those bags to those types of groups if they needed them.
On the Adopt a Highway program, when they provide the bags, what is it, bags and vest?
They give you bags, vests,
and gloves.
And gloves. Yes, sir. That is correct.
Okay. All right.
I think, Mr. Chair, at one time the county did provide those, because when I was with the ROTC twice a year, we picked up several miles of road, and the county provided basically the same thing without the gloves. But I do have a thought here. I'd kind of like for our proposed civilian community committee to have a look at these options and have a say in the consideration and decision.
So, has anything been presented to them yet?
They're still in the infancy of being formed. Remember, you all asked for the cities to bring. So we just, you guys just
nothing's
adopted
happened.
This. So they haven't. The only one that we've got one so far was from DARPA. So good stewards. We're waiting for the cities, and you all have to appoint somebody at our next meeting.
Okay. Has the cities already adopted that resolution? Do you know if it's done, went around to the municipalities yet?
As soon as you guys adopted it, I sent it to them the next day. So whenever they meet monthly, so. Some of them may, some of them may have not.
Okay.
Ronnie, you had a number of proposals here that showed expenses. Where would the money come from?
The bulk of it would, I would assume the board would want to take from the landfill enterprise fund. Now, DOT will reimburse the county up to $30 per mile for roadway cleaned. So if it's an organization we're promoting or providing bags to, things like that, we can report those miles to DOT.
$30 a mile?
Yes, sir.
Most of these had $100,000 in expenses to start up.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is most of that money the vehicle?
Yes, sir.
Would there be a scope for using the same vehicles that the sheriff uses that we've already bought?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand the first
one. Is there a potential to use the vehicles that the sheriff uses for his cleanup crew?
I think it would be if they're driven by county staff. I don't think if it's somebody in the general public, they're not allowed to drive our vehicles. So it'd have to be like, either somebody with county staff like myself or a code enforcement or a deputy.
I heard.
Not all your options include us providing transport, though, right?
Yeah, they do.
They do?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's worth $100,000 startup.
Yeah.
Well, I'm looking at the groups that might be involved. We're not. Are we providing vehicles to those?
No, not for the
volunteer. The nonprofits and faith-based groups. No, sir. But those are the ones we're reimbursing up to $50 a mile if they're willing to clean the roadway.
Okay. I would have some concern about them driving the vehicles that the sheriff is using to transport inmates. One, I don't know, those vehicles marked with sheriff?
They are, yes, sir.
All right, that's number one. But yeah. Number two, if they're going to put inmates back in them, I'd just assume that not. My recommendation is not put anybody else out of the contraband getting left behind.
Yeah.
And then when we talk about some of the startup, did you look at or have you considered? I know one time I spoke to the manager about if we did some type of part-time pool, and we had to look at using or perhaps using some type of one of our surplus vehicles, surplus van or something like that, that would help lessen the initial startup cost associated with this project. I know that other municipalities had done that, looked at the surplus vehicles and utilized one of those simply because it's it was available.
And I think we could do the same if we have a vehicle available and if the board decided on a direction they wanted to go with the program, then we could look at what assets we had in place and if we could utilize them for that program at that time.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Commissioner Travis.
Yes, sir. Mr. Chairman, you know I've been talking about this for a couple of months, but it's been based on talking to everybody I can that looked like a lot of people was like a mixture of all the options. Like instead of 8 part-timers, have 4 part-timers and a supervisor of the litter program that can coordinate with other organizations like Rensco House. They might want to go out and do 4 or 5 miles, one month to get paid. Every organization out there is always looking for some type of money, and this would be a way for like the Rockingham County Booster Club or a football team or something like that to be able to do something. But the problem I come across is having that commitment, and they might go out there 1 or 2 months and everything's great, and then they'll stop. So then you're going to have to get into a contract negotiation probably with them to make sure they at least sign up for a year or something, or 6 months or something. So it's my recommendation that you do a mixture of two options, options 3 and option 5. Kind of mix the two. Instead of having 8 part-timers, have 4 with a supervisor, and then there's extra money used to reach out to some organizations to use.
And who's supervising all of this?
That's what you will hire.
So you hire a supervisor and you hire part-time staff.
Right, and that supervisor will also coordinate with the organizations and community. They can also work with community service and say, hey, if you got community guys going out, we need this area picked up or whatever. The supervisor would be a full-time position.
And with these additional expenses, are you anticipating being able to do that with current revenues in that fund?
I think we would, before I answer that, I prefer just guidance from the board. Here's what we want to do, and let us go back and look at it and see exactly what equipment we have available, if we have to buy equipment, those types of things, and come back to the board with that. I'm not sure I'm prepared to answer that tonight.
Is that something that you could provide the board as we get closer to our budget workshop, that you can let us know?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
This
I'll
is
be glad to.
As Commissioner Travis said, this is a hybrid of what you presented.
Right.
And keep in mind, when you talk about number of part-time employees, if it's part-time, you can have a pool of part-time employees,
that's right,
but
right.
Only work a certain number a day.
Right.
And
we're only allowed 19 hours a week for part-time staff. So
yeah, you've got to stay less than 1,000.
Yeah, exactly.
Do we need to? This was just for discussion. We didn't plan on taking any action on this tonight, so we don't. One of the things we could consider taking action on, you did ask us about the trash bags, the gloves, and the vest. Do we have a cost on associated with that for a group that comes in and got 15 people that want to go pick up, volunteer their time and pick up?
The only one I know roughly is we just purchased two large pallets of the bags specifically for the inmate litter program. They had run completely out, and since the state is reimbursing us per mile, the state is no longer providing those for that program. And we purchased, we spent roughly about $4,000 for two pallets. And I cannot remember how many is on a pallet, but it's enough to last for at least a year, we think.
Mr. Chairman, I kind of agree with you about bags of organizations, but I think it might be for another discussion, because you can get into cities and stuff like that. Are we going to provide bags for everybody in the whole county, or is this just county residents, or is this city? What? So it might be something we need to put on another discussion.
County residents.
Yeah, I was thinking county residents.
I know, but you know, you're gonna provide trash bags for all the cities too.
Yeah.
I mean, we're gonna give them trash bags so they can go out there and pick up their city.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Shaw.
I think it back to Commissioner Richardson's thoughts earlier. You know, we've just formed this committee, or they're in the process of forming. I think this item as well. As Mr. Travis is leading up to, I think that's a good thing to send to that committee as some of their first work as soon as they get formed.
All right. All right. All righty. We'll throw that to the committee. All right. Is any further discussion on this item? Okay. If not, we'll move down to.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you,
Mr. Tate.
Appreciate your work.
We'll move down to item number 11, Captain Jennifer Brain, Captain Shane Bullens, and I see a colonel back there, too.
And a sheriff.
He done snuck in.
Just back from Raleigh.
All right. I'd like to thank y'all for listening to us tonight. Once again, last year we were before you asking for funds to help out with the medical costs for the inmates in our jail. This year it has came back up again. The cost for it this year is right much higher than it was last year. A lot of that contributes to we are still getting bills from last year. In particular, if you can look up to the month of February of 2018, the cost is $109,380.29. Again, that's on our bill for this year. It's just the way the cycle is. For safekeeping, for the medical part, for them billing us, there's no rhyme or reason why they wait so late to bill, but that's just what they do. They have up to a year to bill. Anything over a year, we can refuse payment on that. We do that regular. Doesn't mean that, you know, we're gonna win the fight on that part. Again, most of this is medical costs stemming from having to send an inmate to safekeeping. The total cost is going to be dental, emergency room visits, inpatient surgery, non-routine pharmacy, outpatient surgery, pharmacy, safekeeping, x-rays, and
I need my dog to remove, just get locked up, get in back here.
So the total cost, I think it was two, 253, and then I think we got another bill in Friday. It was for the month of February of 2019. It was right at $14,000. Now, one patient, it was roughly $11,000. It is situations to where the state requires us to give them medical attention, dental attention, anything that's required by the state for us, we have to do it. Yes, sir.
Can you say that one more time? One patient?
One patient.
One inmate?
One inmate.
Was $11,000?
Yes.
Last month?
Of February, yes. We've had him for about 7 months now.
So is that an average he's running? That particular inmate is running about $10,000, $11,000 a month?
Yes, yes.
Where does Medicaid fall in this?
They lose Medicaid after 30 days in jail. They have to reapply for it when they get out of jail.
I'm certain that y'all have had discussions with the DA's office and the judges about moving that along.
That is a fair statement. Yes.
Got a quick several question, times. Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr. Commissioner Travis.
Who's the third party? Who bills you?
Southern Healthcare.
Okay. When's the last time you had an RFP or sent it out to get a different one?
It's one out now.
Okay. You're going to send out another one. So we're going to get a different third party.
Yep.
Okay.
Well, we may keep the same one if they're the cheapest one.
That is correct.
And almost $253,000 ain't much cheaper.
No, there are very few companies that do offer this service in the state of North Carolina, so we are limited by that as well.
Okay.
Do we have
and
a line?
Safekeeping
is a state, right? Safekeeping. We send somebody to safekeeping. That's
a card, right?
That's down in Central Prison, right?
Yes. Yes. And we send them there when the physician says, hey, you know, we can't manage it here. Now, it could be something as simple as, I think we had one like we paid $6.25 extra, not counting what it would have cost to house him here.
This the money that you're asking for tonight, $253,986, that's just to date.
That is correct.
To January.
I think that is an average that will get us through.
That's projected through June.
That's projected, okay.
Yes.
Do you have a line item in your budget for the medical costs?
Yes. We have a line item for the Southern Health Partners. The amount that we pay them for their services includes a cost pool limit of $55,000. Yes. So anything above and beyond that, we are responsible for. Included in their annual fee of a little over $309,000 to Southern Health Partners is that $55,000. But once we exceed that very quickly, and then the rest of the bills are up to us to find.
Sound like it needs to continue.
My point is this great disparity in what the amount of money required versus the amount of money anticipated.
Yeah.
As far as increasing it, we spoke last year with that. It's basically dollar for dollar. So if you increase it $100,000, you know, once you get past that $100,000, you're going to pay dollar for dollar on it.
Well,
you lost me, man. My point is, you got a line item in the annual budget for this, and Jennifer's telling me once you reach a certain point, we get the excess cost.
That is correct.
I'm thinking that line item ought to include whatever we get plus whatever we anticipate as far as a reasonable estimate.
We agree with that as well.
Can we make that happen?
This budget.
I mean, it depends on, we can request the monies. It just depends on whether or not we are allowed in our budget.
You're still taking care of this out of what I would call the sheriff's general budget. That's
no.
We're trying to manage money.
Right.
And we need the most accurate estimates when we do a budget that we can get. this is at least $250,000 different.
Well, unfortunately, we can't control who comes into the jail.
That's right.
I mean, they're coming in sicker. They're coming in with more problems.
Drugs.
And, you know, I can't help but to think on the outside they talk. And, you know, if I need this, you know,
I agree. I know people that said, well, I need to pull a little time because I need some dental work.
Well, I've heard that. Right. I'm just trying to explain to you that we can't control who comes into the jail or what they're coming in for and what they're struggling with.
And I agree with you, Shane. And the fact of the matter is you actually have one inmate that's going to be over half of what you're asking for. And it isn't like that you can do a preventive care like for the county employees.
Right.
You're subject to whoever gets incarcerated and gets put in the jail by the judge or by the magistrate, and you're obligated by statute to treat their medical needs.
And a lot of these are, you know, inmates that are in on some severe charges.
Yeah.
So it's not like, you know, they're going to get a written promise to come back to court. I mean, they're in for some serious charges. We go to the DA's office and speak with the DAs. We speak with attorneys trying to get them out. And, you know, it's a process.
How is are you still utilizing your pre-arrest?
Yes.
I mean, pre-trial?
Yep.
Electronic monitoring?
Yes.
Do we need to look at expanding that program? Would that possibly help this out a little bit?
It would help, Shane, I'm sure. It would help, but it may require adding a person because one person is monitoring, I think, up to 25, and we're splitting that. I think we're having our detectives actually on call helping to cover, so we don't have to have an extra person on that side. But we add 25 more, we're going to figure out how to monitor that addition.
How much do you pay your monitors? I would surmise it's less than $250,000.
But we're talking apples and oranges here.
No, we're not.
Let me finish, sir. If someone is in safekeeping, charged with murder, and the person is sickly or in bad condition where we can't look after his medical, we have to put him somewhere. We can't put a person with murder or any other serious offense out of electronic monitoring.
I accept that.
But pretty much what I'm saying is if a person is in for a serious offense such as murder and he requires the medical attention, we don't have a lot of choice. But I think what you're saying is we need to figure out a way to budget and try to get an estimate. So we're kind of ahead of this.
You're exactly right. And you just mentioned that if you got 24 more people out there with ankle bracelets, you'd have to hire another monitor. But, you know.
Again, we can look at that.
And also keep in mind that we aren't able to choose who goes out on electronic house arrest. We have to go to the district attorney who evaluates what they are incarcerated for and then determines whether or not they can be released. And as the sheriff said, depending on the seriousness of the offense, depends on whether they would even consider them for house arrest. Also note that in the past budgets we have inquired about increasing this line item, but you know it was told that at this point if we did increase the actual cost pool limit, let's say we increased it from $55,000 to $100,000, then we would automatically pay that $100,000 in addition to what we are, our cost, our annual cost would go up. And then once we reach that amount, we're still in the same boat. So it's just looking at how much we can get or how much it looks like. We've looked at the past years to see what we are averaging on these inmates.
I got you. You guys are obviously the expert on this. My plea to you is to get the figure more predictable for those of us that have to look at an overall budget. And what other means, ankle bracelets, what have you, different bids, I would encourage you to use.
And if you don't use it, you can go back in the fund and get it next year. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Colonel, in regards to your request, we'll be definitely looking at
that. Okay. We appreciate all your efforts. I know you can't predict who's coming and who's going, but we certainly appreciate all your efforts in this. Appreciate you communicating with the DA's office and the judges and trying to move those things along. So
thanks.
I'll make a motion that we approve this.
I got a motion by Commissioner Berger. Do I have a second?
You do.
Got a second by Commissioner Richardson. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Ayes have it. Thank you. We have a hard time figuring out what we're going to do with employees from time to time, so I can imagine with inmates. Is that correct, Mr. Manager?
When you Mr. Chair, I was going to mention just one thing. Just to give you a perspective, and there's something that's going on in the system. Either the those out there are learning the system, but in 2010, our actual costs were $226,650. And in 2019, they've jumped to $704,371. So it's
Oh, I know. I mean, they talked about one inmate, but if you get a female prisoner that gives birth in Washington incarcerated, there's a cost associated with that, I believe, too. So, but
I'm just glad there's been no heart transplants around that.
Not this year, but
there's been some transplants.
It's happened.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All righty. New business. We don't have any new business, but I'm going to ask Fire Marshal William Lingle to come forward and introduce a new employee. While we got just a minute. I'm going to get a cup of coffee while he makes his way up.
Good evening, Commissioners. This is a very exciting day for me because now we have an assistant fire marshal with me in the office. This is Miss Melissa Joyce. She comes to us from PTI Airport, where she was a fireman there, and also Northwest Rockingham Fire Department Station 130. Her chief is here to support her in this decision to make her employment with us. So I hope the county and y'all are welcoming to her. And I know she's extremely excited for the position, just so. And I'm excited to have her here.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you very much and welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you. All righty, the next item on the agenda is Commissioner Comments. And I'll start with Commissioner Travis, who I know did the team up to clean up.
It is our good spoken about. Thank you.
All righty, Commissioner Richardson.
Yeah, I just want to endorse what our Partnership for Children are doing with the Dolly Parton Library. If you're looking for a worthy charity that benefits the entire community, $25 will take care of a child in Rockingham County for an entire year. Getting them appropriate literature to improve their learning skills and reading skills. So by all means, get involved with the Dolly Parton Library if you want to do something constructive for the community. I'm going back to litter for just a second. The options that you saw presented by our county engineer are based on folks other than the ones that put trash out, picking up trash, basically cleaning up after somebody else. I think ultimately the real solution is going to be when we can get our citizens as a whole to not put trash out, not put litter out, and if they do, by any chance, see that sort of mess, pick it up on the spot. I've just been kind of keeping up personally, and I try to pick up 10 pieces of trash a day. It's a piece of cake because on the weekend when I pick up in front of the house and along my right of way, I get hundreds. So, you know, think about that making it a personal habit, picking up trash, and certainly advocating for not putting trash out to begin with. At least your children and folks that you have contact with that you might see, let's say inadvertently, creating litter. Encourage them to be part of the solution rather than the problem.
That's all I have, sir.
Thank you, Commissioner Richardson. Commissioner Hall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate everyone who showed up tonight. Appreciate your participation. I want to thank the county staff who worked this weekend on not only on the Adopt a Highway last week, but one of the ones that wasn't mentioned in the team up to clean up, I saw our county manager out there over the weekend as well at Moorhead. We appreciate your service as well. And all the citizens, all the City of Eden employees, school folks who participated at Moorhead, that was a great event. It was very meaningful, I feel like, as well. So thank everyone for their participation in that. And appreciate those who brought up the food drive tonight. That's a very important need, ongoing need in the community. So hopefully, if you're able to participate in that, you will be. And that's it. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Commissioner Hall. Commissioner Berger.
And just to follow up with Commissioner Hall said, that website is rcfooddrive.org to give you some information on the food drive. Appreciate y'all coming out tonight and those watching through the efforts of Roy, and we appreciate everything that Roy does. Yeah. Also want to mention that we have a program that had a record month last month. Register of Deeds Ben Curtis started the passport program when he was elected to office. This past month, there was a record 135 passports issued. Part of that is some organizations have kind of scaled back. So we appreciate his efforts, and if you need a passport, please visit the Register of Deeds. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll be very brief. The team up to clean up was this past Saturday. I had something I couldn't be there, but I know Commissioner Travis, Commissioner Hall was there. And like has been stated earlier, I think we had a great turnout, and it was really good. It's appreciate everything that everybody did. It's a great way to volunteer, and I can think of no better way to volunteer your time and services is towards creating a clean environment for our children to learn. With that said, I'll now entertain a motion that we go into closed session in accordance with General Statute 143-318.114A, location or expansion of industry, and 143-318.1185, instruct negotiating agents.
So moved.
I got a motion by Commissioner Hall. Do I have a second by Commissioner Berger? Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
A like sign, no. Motion passes. I don't expect that we'll have anything major to announce at the conclusion of our closed session, but thank you all for coming out tonight.